Let's have the second staff, 195. And now, oh, one. Tenors also, and one, two, and T. One, two, T, one. Two, and.
The minute I saw the name Robert Shaw, I said, I'm interested.
The name Robert Shaw has been kind of a godlike figure.
He's a legend.
I grew up baking Christmas cookies to all of his Robert Shaw Choral recordings.
When you put Carnegie Hall with it, it compounded it.
An opportunity that's just too good to pass up.
I received the notice in the mail, and I read it, and I thought, wouldn't it be wonderful? And then I put it away thinking, no, I couldn't do that.
And I saw the announcement on the bulletin board, and I said, wow, this is for me. I've always wanted to go to Carnegie Hall. Dare I try?
There was no question in my mind once I received it.
Well, I may not have a chance at it, but nothing ventured, nothing gained.
And then I got it out again, and I thought, I'm going to do it.
So I did prepare an audition tape, and the miracle occurred, and here I am.
Well, as you know, we're celebrating our centennial season throughout this entire year at Carnegie Hall. And while it's our mission to give concerts on a regular basis here in the hall, and that's something we do on a daily basis, we decided that we really wanted to come up with some projects that would say we really care about what's happening in the profession of music, what's happening with music making in our country, and find ways that we could make a contribution to the future.
I was honored to be asked to participate in Carnegie Hall's 100th anniversary year. It was Judith Aaron, I think, who was the first person to suggest that as part of the centennial celebration, we gather a chorus from around the country to spend the better part of a week in New York City preparing the Brahms Requiem, culminating in a performance at Carnegie Hall. We decided to use a corps of singers and conductors who had worked together in our festival in France and who were familiar with our techniques. And then we opened up participation to chorus masters from all over the United States. Carnegie Hall took care of mailing notices to the extensive network of conductors that exists. We had more than 400 applicants. Each sent a tape, and eventually it was narrowed down to a balanced 145 singers from 35 states, as well as 65 auditors.
Robert Shaw has been part of the Carnegie Hall family since the 1940s when he founded the Collegiate Chorale and brought it to our stage. At the same time, he was leading the Fred Waring Glee Club in daily national radio broadcasts. So respected was his work that he was invited to prepare choruses for Arturo Toscanini, Bruno Walter, and Serge Koussevitzky. In 1947, he formed the Robert Shaw Chorale, with which he toured and recorded for the next 17 years. He was selected by George Sell to be associate conductor and director of choruses of the Cleveland Orchestra in 1956, a post he held until he was appointed music director and conductor of the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra in 1967. Mr. Shaw built the Atlanta Symphony and its chorus into one of America's best-regarded ensembles. Since 1988, he has been Atlanta's music director emeritus and conductor laureate. Throughout all these years, Robert Shaw has set the standard in America for excellence in choral singing. Just as there is only one Carnegie Hall, there is only one Robert Shaw, and we want to share him with as many people as possible.
While very few of us make our entire livings with our voices, most of us are associated, at least circumferentially, with some aspects of professionality in music. And it is our trust, it seems to me, and our intention that in the next two or three days we can turn out a really first-rate musical product by bringing these stores of musicality, which are not necessarily vocal, not limited at least to vocal, by intensity and by good musicality, turn out a really significant performance of one of the great products of Western civilization. Our rehearsal premises are two. First, we don't want to waste vocal gold. We don't want to wear out voices in rehearsal. And we're serious about that. And second, we don't try to handle all of the choral disciplines at one and the same time. As a result, we do a lot of very, very light singing. Indeed, so light that we find it unnecessary in the first rehearsal to sing except for occasional relief above a piano. And we feel that the first rehearsal should avoid complicating the learning process by trying to learn text, pronunciation, and dynamics. So we'll work very, very, very quietly. We move now to beginning rehearsal, and I want to say a word or two about warm-ups in beginning rehearsal. It's been my experience through the years in both rehearsal and performance situations that a chorus benefits from a sort of a warm-up period before they get ready to go on stage, or from preferably actually on stage. But I've not found it productive to engage in that sort of why-oh, sort of a vocal tyranny that used to terrorize my early years. Our warm-up procedures then are calculated, one, to achieve a sensitivity to pitch and rhythm, and two, a sensitivity to the stresses of dynamic change and vocal color, but not the first time, and to become acquainted with our acoustical space. Let's do a few things of warm-up first. Would the back row stand first? You may want to, this doesn't improve your voice at all, but it makes you feel a lot better. I mean, just stretch. And almost all voice teachers, as you know, agree about almost nothing. But one thing they agree that I, at least in my experience, is that a yawn doesn't hurt anybody. And if you get yourself a little loose, and you people who are sitting down, sit as straight as you can and a little forward on your chairs. And then take this, I mean, has this thing got pedals? Yes, what got pedals? Three. Sing as quietly as you may be possible. N-double-O, new. Again. Sing knee, N-double-E. Crescendo. Slow crescendo. And brighten at the same time. Now we begin to use the room, and we'll find out that there isn't a great deal of real difference between the piano and the forte. It fills the room with the same sort of N-double-E again and brighten. To forte. Now, short attacks that last for one beat and about a second. In a slow, sing new, off, new, off. New, off. Piano. Pianissimo. Now, in 16, raise this pitch, in 16 attacks, raise this pitch to a half step up, which means that we're sharpening a 16th of a semitone with each attack. Ready? Three, four. We should be halfway between now. Don't rush. Now, what the great temptation will be to stay with this note. And then as soon as you smell this one, to move in a hurry, so. And you will also find that it'll be easier to sharp as you sing the note rather than during the silence and come in a 16th of a step up, you see? Ready? Three, four.
Our warm-up exercises begin with trying to teach some familiarity with what good intonation is. And so we begin with a very, very quiet voweling on a middle low pitch, which is in everybody's register, and then ask them to to heighten that pitch, but we ask a very specific thing, and that is to move from, say, an E natural to an F natural, which is the next adjacent note on the piano, not by moving up that half step, but by moving up to that half step in increments of 1/16th, so that they arrive from, though they begin on E natural, they arrive on F natural 17 steps later. Now, we're fooling ourselves a little bit because nobody can do it, but there's somehow a wonderful sort of group instinct and group sensitivity that makes this sort of an exercise possible and makes everybody immediately acutely sensitive to sharpness or flatness of tonality.
When we began the warm-up, the technique of raising the note a step within 16 steps was new to me, and I was thinking, how am I even going to hear this, much less do it? But somehow it came along.
These warm-ups are different than what I'm accustomed to and what I do with my choir, although not so different from what I'm going to try to do when I go back home, because they seem to warm up the mind, perhaps more than warm up the voice.
It's also considerably more difficult to sharp because of harmonic implications. Take bass and alto on the low, on the D, and this is an F sharp for the sopranos and tenors. Try to sharp this in 16 steps. And keep it in tune. Going to be a good choir. Now, as quietly as possible, sing new, begin on new, and substantially begin with head voice, even in this sort of middle register. And it's because we're going on up and then so on. There's a new begin. Keep the ah vowel very, very quiet, and it's all right if you want to slide a little bit, you know. But keep the ah vowel very, very quiet and absolutely in tune. Three and four. Off. Use falsetto and head voice. Use falsetto. Assessment was that it was going to be very good, and that was due particularly to our sort of, they're called warm-up exercises. They're not really warm-up exercises in the sense we obviously don't teach voice master voice. Again, is so special and so personal that it's, I'm sure that some things can be taught in class, like posture and breathing, and there are some fundamentals, but the specifics of each voice is so innately and acutely different that it's difficult to do any of the very severe changes or the very sensitive changes that might be possible in teaching voice, other than to do them person by person. Bravo. Two parts. Use eight beats to do it. Crescendo and brighten it. Brighten the tone. Three, four. Brighten it to the point that it becomes unusable. That is to say, it becomes over bright and somewhat ugly. It won't hurt you. It won't hurt us in this register, but at least experience what an over bright sound is. Three. Move from dark to bright. That is to say, don't begin bright. Crescendo and move from dark to bright. Great. Move from bright to dark.
and pianissimo to forte. Both sounds ought to be a part of our arsenal, you know, ought to be a part of our vocabulary.
We don't want to waste voice. What we're trying to do in those warm-up exercises is tease people and culture them into real pitch sensitivity and also into very quiet singing, so they substantially use half voice or no voice.
Now sing as quietly as you may. Sing one and two and T. We're going to do a lot of count, what we call count singing. Because I find it's the fastest way to unify sectional sounds and to unify metric divisions. And we use, instead of singing one and two and three and four and, because three has the TH and the R, which takes a lot of time and will delay the vowel, we sing one and two and T and four and. Slowly, to, on unison, three and four. One and two, yeah. Half that loud, two, three and four. Again, repeat, and one, two. Now, one and a two and a T and a four. One and a two. Good, 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 good. Let me say a word about Norman Mackenzie, too, because it's been in the eighth decade of my life. I can only wish that when you reach your eighth decades and you have choral rehearsals, that you have a musician with the gifts of this man and so gracious in sharing his gifts. Norman, let's go to work. Be seated. Be seated, and we'll begin right at the top. Three and four. Count singing, numbers, and someplace between three pianos and two pianos. Measure phrases, and then 2-3 measure phrases, and it works beautifully out. If you have the T, put it on. Zin, put it on too, see? Intonation, and one and two and four 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 and one and two and four. Crescendo for one beat, diminish for one beat.
One and two and four and one.
Don't forget the diminuendo. Crescendo. Crescendo.
And one and two.
Choir singer, as he reads, shouldn't be asked to
handle all of music's facets at once, all of their responsibilities or all of their devices. That is to say, we try to take out all matters of textual management or of textual discipline, and also all disciplinary factors of dynamics, so that one is singing substantially within a piano to double piano range, and one is sort of counting the notes and or singing them with nonsense syllables rather than singing with text. We find that if we can use these sort of musical disciplines rather than textual disciplines from the beginning, we can get a cleaner product and one which is more more refined musically. I remember when I first came with Mr. Sell and the Cleveland Orchestra, I asked him one time after I'd been there for a few months why he'd hired me in that capacity as an associate conductor, in particular my responsibility is conducting the choral programs. And he said, well, Robert, he says, because you treat the chorus the same way I treat an orchestra. And I hoped it didn't mean that at that moment that it was the severity with which he occasionally treated his orchestra. But he meant, I think, that we were using what were primarily almost instrumental disciplines to pursue choral degrees of finesse and nicety and cleanliness as he used in his orchestra.
Also on a thing like that, one, two, and if it just has a little separation, you know, it will help. All right, let's have the second staff, 195. And now, one. Tenors also, and one, two, and two, one, two, two, one, two, and T, and one, two, and T, and one and two, and one and two, and one and two, hey, and one and two, T and one, two, T and one, two, T and one and T, and one, two and T, four and one, two, T, four, one and two and T. Right. Good. And it will do us good to sing T and four and one and two and T and sing the ands, because we'll begin to place the end. This is terribly difficult to get those to go with instrumental clarity on the second eighths of the second and fourth beats. Let's begin right at the top of the page and begin right on the downbeat. And sing one and two and T and four. One, two, ready.
One and two and T.
I'll just say things that occur to me. You'd be surprised how you can undiscipline a choir by beginning that with text the first time. I mean, you can just, you'll never get it right. You can't get there from here. But if you'll wait, you know, until our performance is Saturday, is Sunday at 3 o'clock, if we wait till about Monday afternoon before we put words with it, it'll be wonderful. It'll be wonderful. Ready? Here we go, top of the page. One, two, three, four.
Count singing takes a lot of concentration. It's not only do you have to concentrate on the one and two and T and four and, which is new to me, but also it helps you focus more on the particular notes you're singing. I find my intonation is better when I'm doing that rather than concentrating on words at the same time.
Robert Shaw has a wonderful way of trying to isolate one or two technical things to work on at a time. And so you're not overloaded with all these things coming at once with text, melody, and pitch.
For instance, if you have to sing the same note for eight beats, then you have to sing it, if you're singing one and two and three and four, you have to sing it eight times right, you see? And then that means that people aren't sliding up to the pitch because they have to begin on one, or aren't sliding off the pitch because then they have to sing eight and on that pitch before they can go on to the next one. And this forces such a discipline of particularity that it just immediately clarifies a choral fabric.
Ready? Let's begin right at G. Three, four, and
one, two, four, one, two.
One. Now go down. Four. Don't do this.
Two, one, two, three, four, two, three, four, one, two.
The tendency is to sing long notes slow and to sing short notes fast, which is a good tendency, because obviously it's what the composer has in mind is more motion. But what you're doing is just killing the eighth note motion over here by being too slow on your quarters. Ready? Same spot, letter G. Three, a four, and one. Yeah, tipipa, no nuance of tempo. Nuance of tempo would be all right if it were a solo line, you know, and you had to never have anything but a continual chord underneath it. Then and then you might be entitled to, if the text were particularly expressive, you might be entitled to some nuance of tempo. But no unintended nuance of tempo, and when four voices plus whatever in the orchestra is going on is moving against you, you're not allowed, you know, to destroy qualities of tempo. Three, a four, and one, and two.
The reason we stay away from textual stimulation or technical mastery for so long is because it's so difficult to combine with singing unless one knows very particularly what one has to do as to intonation and dynamics first and to rhythm. One can just simply ruin voices in a hurry by trying to do all of these things at one time. The voice is so dependent upon sort of psychological stimulation, since it can't be touched and manipulated, that if one tries to do too much, and when one isn't ready to reach for this note on this particular syllable, simply by the fact that he doesn't know quite where the note's going to be, then he's liable to strip all of his vocal gears at once and have nothing left for the performance or the end of rehearsal. We try to do it with constantly very light or head voice until we feel that we sort of know the piece very securely in terms of its intonation and in terms of its rhythmic articulations and such. And then we add the dynamics, which call for more vocal effort and more vocal strain.
You'll be lightly here. Now you'll crescendo here enormously.
T and four and one and two, and four and one. T and four and one and two, and T and four, one and two, and T and four.
Right, that's a little bit overphrased, and it's necessary to get the syncopation and to line it up with the running eighth notes. Obviously, the next step is to do this kind of rehearsal half singing text and half singing numbers. Odd numbers sing text, even numbers sing numbers, and when I say reverse, and then we'll reverse two or three times while we're going through at the same time. And the purpose not now is not to get the vowels correct, wonderful, Austrian, German, or whatever Miss Jones is going to have us sing here, but to get our consonants together and to get the vowels arriving at the same time as the numbers. We begin with the top page 20. People who are singing text sing more lightly than the people who are singing numbers. Ready? Because they'll keep you honest. And now,
one, two, three.
You people who are rehearsing singing text, two things. Don't allow yourself a vibrato every time you get to a beginning of a note. Save your vibrato for purposes of expressivity. Almost invariably, voices, and particularly choral voices, will, if they have any vibrato problem at all, which confuses pitch, you'll hear about it at the beginning of each note, you know? And rather than saving as the great popular singers have done, including Sinatra and others, and instead of saving vibrato as a means of expression, they just, it's a given, and I can't get rid of the darn thing, sort of a thing. We don't hear any of that when you're counting numbers, you know? The notes are perfectly under control, but there shouldn't be any, we shouldn't hear any more of that when we're singing text than we do when we're singing numbers. Okay, let's go back top of the page and begin the same way. And a three, four, one, and two.
Two, and four, one, and two, and two, and 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 one, and two
May I say another thing while it occurs to me? That is to say, I think also, we know that, all of us know that composers are motivated by text, and particularly with a work like the Brahms, like Brahms' Requiem, where he chose the text. And he chose, and he specifically chose, you know, not to use the traditional text. He's concerned more about the living than he is with the dead. It's not until movement 7 that he begins to be blessed are the dead. It begins with blessed are they that mourn. And substantially, every piece is consolation and for those remaining rather than for the prayer for the souls of the dead. And the loudest part, there's no dies irae, which is too bad because the dies irae is an incredible artistic achievement as well as a cannibalistic wonder and philosophically and. But he doesn't have a dies irae for us. What I'm getting to is that the composer is concerned with the text, but if we're interested in finding how the composer is concerned with the text, then we satisfy the composer's musical directions, and we may get a little glimmer. But we don't get it by imposing our own religiosity on it.
I also must say that though we're very conscious of the fact that a composer begins with a text, and that it's his inspiration in certain respects, but the responsibility of the performer, it seems to me, is to satisfy as nearly as he can the composer's language, and then seek what the insight of the composer the way he might have felt towards the text, rather than arriving at a textual philosophical relationship with the text, which is one's own personal interpretation, and forcing that upon the composer. I can remember once that somebody said that Bach was the greatest witness to the crucifixion of Jesus, not because he happened to be present, but because he was a witness to the meaning of the crucifixion. And I must say that it seems to me that people who use the passions of Bach as a sort of a preachment of their own particular religiosity are liable to miss Bach's language, are liable to miss Bach's feeling about the crucifixion.
Crescendo. Everybody text.
Using the count singing enlivens the rhythmic quality of the music. And it very much accomplished that today as we were rehearsing. It brought the piece to life in a very vital way that one typically doesn't find in a piece like this, that's very frequently legato and sustained. And this count singing helps to energize that type of singing.
Mr. Shaw uses some different techniques of count singing and that's great, but once you add the text, it really makes the music come alive, and for me, that was the most exciting part of the day.
It's really a thrill when we finally start working with the real words, because then the music is revealing itself to us as well as it will to the audience, because we've worked at it in a different way, and so then that's really exciting.
Be sure that the vowels begin on the beat. Say f. Say v. Yeah, see, each of those is longer than a quarter note. And it has to be ahead of the beat. Now, we can shorten them, but the point is, get them ahead of the beat or ahead of the division of the beat. Ready? Here we go. 3, 4, 1. Hey. the way best to get this is to deny yourself the pleasure of singing consonants. Sing the vowels only. 3, 4, 1. A E. A E. Now sing numbers. Ready? And now. 1. That was better intonation than we had on the vowel when we were singing, you see. And gradually by doing a little bit of this at each rehearsal and stuff, and never, you know, and on the day of the performance, go back to numbers and stuff like that, it begins to sharpen up intonation so that even on a very difficult vowel like an A, you can sing in tune. 3, 4, 1, 2. Text. No consonants.
I'm a conductor, and I worked very hard for clarity in the singing that my kids did. But going from that kind of concept of counting to text, I heard a loss of certain kinds of things that I wanted to still maintain in the ensemble, going to clarity of rhythm and shaping that we lost when we went to text. But we'll get that back. I mean, the counting is a means to an end. And it's a great thing to do. And when you do finally hone something that well, and then you get to add that next level to it, it's an incredibly gratifying experience.
Right. It's an hour and 10 minutes. Doesn't feel like it, did it? Better take a break. 10 minute break. Isn't it? Time passes when one is having fun. Page 1. Three measures, 3, 4, and 1. Numbers for a moment, and scale the crescendo diminuendo in the second measure that we sing. Crescendo. This reminds me that there is within every crescendo, you know, within every diminuendo, there's a sort of a moment of intensification too. For me, a diminuendo goes like this, you know, to reach its point. For you, it obviously that's a crescendo for you, Charles. it doesn't surprise. But the point is that while this is going, there may be all sorts of, you know, while it's getting down here, there may be all sorts of little curves down here, and the general sound is getting lesser, but there may be moments of intensification within it. Don't let a diminuendo be a collapse of energy, but an intensification of energy. What has to happen is that you get more and more energy into less and less tone, you know, more and more energy until it all becomes just like this. So this resent this diminuendo that happens in 76. 3, 4, 5, 6. Going on from where we stopped. You lost a little bit of the cover as you went to the E vowel, to the slightly flatter vowel in terms of its quality. Don't lose that lovely color that you had. Give them the measure before. And 1, 2, 4. And bravo. And you know, it's enormously difficult to be a singer. It's just terribly difficult.
And the chief mistake we make when we, you know, is that we don't realize how difficult it is. We think, oh, you know, just and even a little thing like that takes all of a sudden the sweetness out of the line when the change of vowel doesn't keep the same warmth. Yeah. What reminds me is that, and I think it's a cardinal principle, and we must hold to it, and that is that we don't say, you know, blend, you dummies. What one says is either the pitch is wrong, or the vowel is wrong, or the dynamic is wrong, or the vibrato is wrong, or something. I mean, to tell people to blend is counterproductive. Get the vowel and the pitch together. Then we'll be all together. Three, four. One, two, and three. Now carry the upper voice down at this moment. Carry the upper voice down. Bass crescendo. I wonder if anybody's ever had as much fun at a first rehearsal as you're giving us. Now, don't drink yourselves to death tonight. just because you're in a big city, just because you're big city. Remember, there's a chance that we could have another amendment to the Constitution and outlaw it altogether. Ready? See you mañana. Hasta la vista, 10 o'clock a.m. Good. Thank you, Norman. Thank you. Stretch. I wish you could have seen New York in 38 and 39 and 40 and 41 and 42. It was so clean. You could see it. Thank you.
begin to these notes. No, we'll make these, bass and alto, soprano and tenor, and begin, sing one, and then quarter note rest. Ready? Sing knee, knee, knee. Three, four. Quarter note rest. All right, now, begin forte, and do eight of them, and get to piano. And within each one, within the quarter note, a little bit of crescendo. Two, three, four. That's, now you still got five to go, you know, three to go in your piano. You don't know what a diminuendo is, you know, it's hardly, it calls for enormous energy to make one. Ready? Two. Begin. Let's make it even more difficult. Begin double forte, and then poco double forte, and then poco forte, and then mezzo forte, and then poco mezzo forte, and then mezzo piano, and then poco mezzo piano. So you have double forte, forte, mezzo forte, mezzo piano, piano, double piano. You have six, but you have 12 because you have the half dynamic in between. This is double forte. And each one has a crescendo in it. Three, four. Poco double forte, forte. Poco forte, mezzo forte. Poco mezzo forte, mezzo piano. Poco mezzo piano, piano. Poco piano, double piano. But now you forgot the crescendo in each one. Got? Which is terribly difficult. You know, I mean, that, the point is that the diminuendo has to be energized constantly, constantly. Sing gnaw, two, three, four. Front rows, turn around, face the back, and step back a little bit. Step back, step towards the center, that is to say. Ready, here we go again. Knee, begin. Change vowels. Change rapidly. Change rapidly. Change rapidly. Keep going, keep going. Same thing, change rep, and everybody turns slowly around, so you're 360 degrees, and keep turning. Begin first, knee, sing. Crescendo, change vowels, turn around. Turn around, come on, crescendo. Crescendo! 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 Don't sing anymore and you can keep in tune. Two parts. Same thing. And so they're constantly facing a changing acoustical environment, and get into the pitch, everybody. Knee first. Begin. Turn.
We've always worked in circles simply because when they're singing towards one another, they can hear. They can hear the total product. And so this turning around accomplishes first that it gets used to the sound of the stage. Usually, that's this sort of moving around while one is trying to tune, or turning around in place, and either in rehearsal space or in performance space, is to see that the intonation, the factor of 441 or 440 being A and 441 not being A, or 439 not being A, is to see that each member of the chorus is facing a different acoustical environment, facing the different back of somebody's head, or the different face of somebody's face, and so that one is singing directly into another person or directly by another person. Two things are accomplished. The first is getting used to the space. The second is getting used to a varying impact of sound from varying sources, but trying to identify in terms of pitch with it. Or in terms of voweling, either, or in terms of brightness, or in terms of crescendo, that is a change of dynamics. We use those exercises when we're trying to crescendo for as much as 30 seconds, or diminish for as much as 30 seconds, when we're trying to brighten our vowels or darken the vowels, to see what influence brightness or darkness or increase of sound or decrease of sound has upon the pitch. And also then trying to relate one voice to the other so that the people make their adjustment.
Give us a D natural, a bass D natural. That is, it's a, that, and tenor, bass, sing that pitch, new, quietly. Tenor, F sharp. Alto, E natural. Soprano, G sharp. We're gonna begin top of page 38. And we're going to sing our text on these notes, absolute monotone, but with perfect rhythm. I'm beginning at measure 173. One tenor's to begin. One di gere ten zelen zint in go tis hunt. With gorgeous enunciation, but like little percussion instruments. Two and three and one. Di gere ten zelen. Do you hear that the syllable ga is not nearly as in tune as those that are coming up to it? Ready again? Three and four and one. Now, don't allow yourself vibrato at the instant of attack. Save it for the longer notes. Three, four, and one. No, you did not ruretzion. The last syllable of ruret was not in time. Three, a four, and a one. You didn't begin in time, ladies. You didn't begin in time. Come on. Now, let's have final consonants. End. One. Gottes Hand und Gottes Hand und. Come on. Get final T's. End. One. Speak. Gottes Hand und. What we're trying to accomplish here is the separation of textual problems from melodic problems and problems of dynamics. That is to say, each section is given its own monotone on which it phonates its own text, and as though it were a percussion instrument, so that the vowels and the consonants are particularly phonated absolutely together in each section, and then each section is given a different pitch. They happen to be a sort of a whole tone cluster so that they can be easily identified, so that we can hear the multiplicity of text going on at the same time. If they were given the same pitch, one would not hear this as clearly as if each section is given a different pitch. Now begin. We're close enough to one another now so we can begin to develop, you know, a sort of camaraderie of counterpoint in terms of text. And begin to listen to other parts too. Sing your own parts so quietly that you can hear at least one to two other parts. Begin with a tenor, with a bass entrance, sorry, at the top of page 42. And now, one. Good. Place, guys, place your... not only against your own line, but place it against their quarter notes, see? This is the point. And three, a four, and one, and...
Vocally, the Brahms Requiem is is as exhausting a piece of music that as a chorus is ever asked to sing. The Mises Solemnis, for instance, is a remarkable athletic tour de force vocally, and it calls for extraordinary heroism and histrionics. But the Brahms calls for a depth of tone, which is almost unforgiving in its demands. I can remember one critic of BM in the early days who said that the Brahms line was like somebody leaning on the chocolate syrup, some sort of soda fountain clerk leaning on and forgetting that his hand was there, and it just keeps running and running till it covers his shoes. And that's so Brahms makes enormous demands that way. And it would be, if one began, as we did 3 days ago, towards this performance, and used that kind of a voice for singing the rehearsals, there simply could have been no performance.
For once, tap on your tape with one hand. Tap your rhythm. And 3, 4, 1, 2. Now you can hear over here that the tenor responses are enormously late, and also enormously confused. It sounds like you're prrp, 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 instead of ta 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 ta. We go again. Tap it. 3, 4, 1, 2. See that? Late, gentlemen. Once again, it should sound T. Ta 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 ta. 3, 4, 1, 2. Now, talk quietly. Talk quietly. Only ta, 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 ta. Your own part, but always on ta. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. Sing it on pitch. Sing it on pitch. Ta and ta. On these pitches. On these pitches. Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. Talk text on this pitch, on these pitches. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. D. I stopped just because it occurs to me. Can you imagine how difficult that would be to try to get the right notes and the right text and the right dynamics all at once, if one didn't engage in this sort of a breaking it down and making it possible for people to find out where it is? This is the only way one can approach this. And then it becomes clean. We go again. Go back. And now Vonungen. Vonungen. And you sang Vonungen. Ready? Vonungen. One. Again, what I'm criticizing is that there's not enough independence of the third beat, of the third syllable, of the third beat and the second syllable. You sang Vonungen, and you blended it all together instead of Vonungen. Ready? Vonungen, 1, 2. Vonungen. Now, again, you run ze into ba. You don't say ze, ba, ah, you see. Once again, same beginning from the top. And one, you're right to criticize this in your own mind. Say, but look at this, this ignores the rise and fall of the melody. And you're militating against melody. Yeah, all we're doing is cleaning up text. And the melody, you'll be surprised how the melody will come back to you, I mean, it will exert its own grace, but first we have to get these notes where they belong and these syllables where they belong. 2, 3, 4. 3, 4. 2, 3, 4.
I see.
Bottom of the page, letter A. Numbers. One and two and, or one, sorry. One, two, T, four, one, two, with proper pitches. Measure 12. Three, a four, and a one. No louder than that, but numbers. One, two, three, four, one, two. One, two, oh, one, two. Oh, one, two, three, four, one. Four, one, two, three, 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 four, one.
Now do it at proper dynamics. It doesn't go high enough to hurt anybody vocally, and we're ready to move a little bit now. And so make much of these crescendi and much of the diminuendo also. Same measures. End one.
Working with training the choruses for the Castells Festival, that I had heard him say, gentlemen, we don't play piano or forte, we play within piano and within forte. So that each note has a life in terms of its dynamics. It's either growing or receding, or sometimes both.
Now, don't any of us deny ourselves the great excitement of being a little bit concerned with the dynamics of the phrase and the contour of the phrase in terms of its dynamics. I'm not talking now for a moment about text. I'm forgetting that. Try to recall what I quoted yesterday about Casal saying we don't sing piano and forte, we sing within piano and forte. All right? Never let two consecutive numbers be of the same dynamic. Always crescendo or diminuendo. Try to stay within piano. Reach up to mezzo piano, but not beyond it. Reach down to double piano, but not below it. You know? But never let a tone go unsterned. Ready? And one. Now make dynamics. Two. One, two. Oh, one, two. Oh, one, two, three, four, one, two. Two, four, one, two, three, four, one, two. Don't slow down. Two, one, two, four, one, two, three, four. Now, watch this, because this is a wonderful spot to learn this. Remember, today we were making diminuendi by putting silences in between. Put a staccato on Ben Ein, which is in measure 24, 25, 26. And the most delicious way to make a staccato, a crescendo will always be a poco sostenuto, and a diminuendo will almost invariably be a poco staccato, not staccato, what I want to say, not sustained, non sostenuto. There's got to be one. Anyway, you understand? So you would sing, Das und mein Leben ein Ziel. And that will allow you to come Leben ein and come down terrace wise. And with a ever so slight separation. Now, take it all with numbers. Beginning, please, third measure, top of the page. One, two, three, four. One, two, eight. That's not enough crescendo. That's enough crescendo had he written it, had he not written any. You know, because the ones that we put in for text or for phrasing purposes to give an arch to the phrase. But if he writes it, then be a little more concerned about it. Yes, that's better. Last two measures, previous page. One, two, three, four. One, three, four.
Every note, no matter what it's, how short or how instantaneous its life, must be allowed its itness, its right to exist. I find that when one is in crescendo, this sort of almost the stress of sustaining is valuable. But when one is in the process of releasing dynamics, then if one can create terraces of this release, it gives I find it gives a syllable. I've used the word particularity many times while we've been talking here, but it gives it a place of its own. I'm unhappy with. I also occasionally mark orchestral parts this way. I'm unhappy that the diminuendo in receding sound, which is called diminuendo, that just sort of ends like this, ends and sort of limp-wristed, and I find that it doesn't give to me a diminuendo should carry an intensity and a quietness to its end, and if it's liable to get very very sluggish and sloppy and syrupy, slurpy, if one does not have this particularity of terrace quality.
Let's begin on number one. And we'll begin three measures before our first entrance. Make it six measures. Begin at measure, just for fun, measure nine. Three and four and one, two. I want to begin with numbers and we'll move to text in a moment on each one. But I want to do each one with numbers first. One and two and ten. Tempo. One and two. Three and four and one and two and three and four and one. Didn't you feel that you carried your crescendo too far? I think you did. I think if you carried it too long and you carried it a little too much. Yeah, I probably shouldn't have put it in, right? And two measures. Tenors, while I think of it, with the soprano, you see the alto's below you. Where are second tenors? Raise your hand. One, two, three, four, five. Sing the alto A instead of the C. And because that's one measure. And one. Go to the E flat also, and see if that's too much. It may be. It's a wonderful, it's a wonderful. It's the only sensitive sort of interval in the change of chords there. It's the most sensitive interval, that is to say, anyway. And one, but do it falsetto. Now sing it where it's written this time, ladies. But numbers. One and two and T, four and one and two, T and four and one, two and T, four and one and two and T, four and one and two. And now float it up. You can do this one, don't try to do the next one.
One and two and
three. Don't forget that two and, the and of two, is very, very quiet. Once again, give us one measure.
One and two and three and four. One and
not too much crescendo. You're lucky to get there. Don't try to force your hand, Force your luck. You don't have to crescendo that. You just sort of look at it and smile, And one, two, three.
Oh, one and two and three. Four and one and two. Oh, one and
no, I said don't do that one. Oh, didn't you remember? Two, now molto crescendo.
One of my particular interests is in the area of vocal health and vocal preservation, in some situations vocal rebuilding. And
the things that he asks of the singer, through particularly through the warm-up procedure and during the entire rehearsal period, is so constantly reaffirming to vocal health and vocal integrity that it was a very, very exciting experience to be able to tie together those ideas with other things that I already know of vocal health.
Forte fortissimo, but no sforzato. Even within forte fortissimo singing, the change of pitch should not be the loudest part. Each tone must be allowed to bloom. Now, that doesn't mean that there used to be a common comic in the old days called Jerry Colonna. And it doesn't mean that each tone should have that crescendo, but it means that has to be, for a moment, it has to be fortissimo minus so that it can bloom to fortissimo plus. And you don't do it, and so again, it shatters as you change pitch, and it's as though you sort of hit your voice with a fist, you know. And again, four measures, and one.
The voice is a reasonably delicate instrument, and to jam the breath against it, to hit a note fortissimo, as we say, you know, three fortes, is an extraordinary strong blow against this poor little thing that just trying to control itself as much as it can, and so even the loudest note that one demands of oneself in singing must be approached with some sort of delicacy and the quality of invitation instead of the quality of rape, you know, so that it may be for a few milliseconds, it may be piano, and then it grows so rapidly that it strikes the ear as a forte note. So I caution singers against hitting the note so hard that it shakes this apparatus and thereby making the pitch fluctuate and thereby making it impossible to place it in relationship with other pitches.
Now let's allow ourselves a little bit more expressiveness on text on Fedoret, just a little bit. Exhausted, you know. One and two. Don't forget on a diminuendo that we're still responsible for a few flips of R's. Doret, a little bit, you know, once again. That's wonderful. It begins to be, you know, when it becomes that personal, then it's so important that a chorus be personal, and I mean the whole meaning, obviously the whole psychology and philosophy of a chorus is common, you know, is community and unity, but the things that most make it apprehensible to the listener are fabulous nuance of dynamics. And then the choir becomes a single psyche, you know, and I'll be happy to, you know, I want to get out of the way of that happening, and the next thing is a little bit, which is almost the same thing, but a little bit of textual explication, almost over zealousness that becomes terribly, terribly personal. Das Gras, and one and two. And Oscar, assist in almost all instances, and I don't know why it happens, it doesn't happen in so much with piano rehearsal, it happens with orchestras, you'll stop singing on Doret and say Doret. Put the T on the third beat. And one, two, three, and one, and be seated, everybody, be seated.
We can do two things. We can go back to counting quietly. One and two, three, four, and one, two, and one, two, five, six, one, two. Quietly, numbers. One and two, T, four, five, six, and one, 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 two, T, four, five, six, one, two, T, four, five, six, and 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 one, two, T, four, five, six, whole tone complex, E, G sharp, F sharp, no, this, dum, 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 E natural, G sharp, no, G sharp, E, tom, tom, T, T, F sharp, A, very simple, a text, and two, and one, no, I don't hear your eighth notes, guys. I mean, come on, we're beginning at 144. We did this morning. Exactly, we're measure 144. Three and three and one. No. Back to top of page, top page 35, second measure. End one. Text on proper notes, but no louder than that. End one. At 3 o'clock and find out what the answer is. Okay. Let's see. Let me have, please, E natural, G sharp, and F sharp, and A sharp. Text. And one, two, and T, and one, and two. I don't, no. I come, but don't hear three quarter notes in measure six. One, two, three, one, and two. No, don't, we're just not together on our third beats. Once again, and one, two, three, two, two. Begin count singing. And one, and two, and. Don't be deep. Quietly. Text, beginning one and two. Uh,
when we stopped singing numbers and started to sing words, it's a wonderful, freeing, completing experience. But even more exciting was when we stopped singing a certain static chord, which we had done all morning long, all the texts we rehearsed, we sang on one chord. Finally, when he said, sing the notes that are on the page, that was like being let loose.
Everything, quality of tone, quality of rhythm, quality of enunciation, finally becomes spirit, you see. And if we fracture tone, we fracture the spirit. The great thing, I mean, the line I love so much is that art is the Christian theology has that the word became flesh. Well, you know, maybe so, depending upon, you know, where you stand theologically. But certainly, the flesh becomes word. On a thing like this, the right quality, the right acoustic, the right vibration, the right physical apparatus becomes spirit. If you and that transition down as you go into what normally would be low register, somehow blending the upper voice on down so that we don't hear again the downshift and the scratch of rubber. It makes an enormous difference. And deep, but they're not precise enough. Again, three, a four, and one. None of that spectacular cohesiveness of rhythm is truth yet. But the point is that we'll never get truth without it. And it still is being disturbed by vocal problems, which exist. That is to say, you know, heightenings and stuff, which it takes a, no wonder tenors hold on to their high notes. There's no way to get down, you know? There's no way to get down. And so this, it's vocal, and it's also being disturbed by elements of enunciation. Anytime we sing numbers, it's absolutely clear. Begin at the same spot we began for a moment. Go back to what was letter G, and sing nonsense syllables. Sing ta 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 or da da da, soft D, just for half dozen measures. Three and four and one and da da. Now sing na na na, sing na 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 na, na 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 na. And a three and a four and na. Na 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 Everybody up, everybody up. And I don't care, but do something that conducts, you know? Wiggle your ears or something. So that we're doing something physical along with the vocal thing. And don't make a big problem out of the vocal thing. And sing ta-da-da-da for, no, sing numbers for a minute. And three and four and one and two. Do the same thing, but odd numbers, sing text. And three and four and one. Go back. Reverse. And three. Three and a four and a one. And. Everybody on text. Everybody on text. And somehow, get choreatic. You know what choreatic means? It means Saint Vitus-y. Make the voice carry the dance. It also has just a little touch of hysteria in it. Ready? Three and a four and a one. Doesn't need to be. Go back to the beginning of the thing. It doesn't need to be that marcato now. Now that it's getting clean. Bass tenors begin. Front row down. Ready? Three, a four, and a one, and it's not. This is not facing all of the problems. But it's facing all of the problems we're capable of solving at this moment. That is to say, until we get this, we can't begin to add, if we begin to add the muscularity that we're going to need eventually, if we add it too soon, we'll never get it in gear, see? And one, two, and... The sweetest tone here, with a little clarity, wonderful tone. Now a hair of crescendo more to Tristan. It was just glorious. Give us that lovely introduction because that makes us sing nicely. And two, three. This was beautiful. That phrase, you don't need to sing the rest of the work at all, you know? Everybody can go home. Isn't it just glorious, just unbelievable that he wrote it just for us? You know, just an unbelievable that the music is, what an incredible leap of faith it is for a man to compose that. You know, unbelievable that man could imagine that we'd be interested in singing it. You know, and here we're dying to do it better. It's just unbelievable. That's what immortality's about, obviously. Let's go on next. Begin at top of page 56, the third measure. N4 and one.
numbers first. When the composer finishes, it's essentially incompleted work of art. And so it puts one in this sort of community effort puts one in touch not only with the present, but puts one in touch with human history. And this is a obviously a great leap of faith on the part of the composer, who I'm not sure that Johannes Brahms could have identified that this particular date and this particular year and this particular century, but he was certainly counting on somebody. No, I hear you stop the word "wird." It must not stop as "wird deposa to D." You may stop the word, but you cannot sing the T if you do. Who are those three people? Are they? Were they here today? And I just feel. Let me just tell you, I feel this way that a community of like this can be broken by two or three people, by absences. I believe that. Isn't that stupid? Ready? No. Ready? No. And 3, 4, 1 and 2 and 3, 1 and 2 and 3, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, 1 and 2 and 3, 4.
If one takes all of the school choruses and all of the university and college choruses and all of the church choirs in the United States, there can't be another artistic activity which has so much so much involvement. It is a community effort by which people, even of limited, vocal endowment or limited instrumental endowment, and can create something which is more beautiful than anyone could do by themselves.
I could never play a violin for a Vicario or something like that. Only the specialists get to do that. But with choral music, people with a little talent and a lot of luck can get all the way up to the peaks of the greatest works ever written with the best people. And that's extraordinary. Absolutely extraordinary. I don't know of any other art that can do that for you.
This is a contemporary participation which allows a person to contribute at his own completely highest level of personal intellectual commitment and personal physical control, personal technical discipline, and only gain new strength and new self and really new self-respect through this this common endeavor.
Stand up back two rows and go to the bottom of page 65, and I'll do just this. I'm doing the shortened thing now, just to see what kind of sonority we can develop. Dan S. Veard. Now sing a comfortable forte. And only sing the first three notes. Den, es, wird, dipo, zau. Go do that. Do up then stop on zau. Ready? And make it forte. And a 1, 2.
Den, es, wird, dipo, zau.
Dipo, zau. Staccato. Ready? Again. And a 1, 2.
Den, es, wird, dipo, zau.
Gentlemen, staccato on the downbeat, will you? Ready? Once again. Now sing it, not double forte, not triple forte, single forte. And 1, 2. Now make a sort of a crescendo on each long note. Ready? And a 1, 2. Now begin double forte and do that. But keep it that steady. And a 1, 2. Good, go on this time. It makes a racket, doesn't it? And a 1, 2. Now you certainly can hear the reason for deepa da 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 da, da 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 da. And as much as you can, because it's a big racket. Here we go. And we'll go right through to the end of this little section, 22 measure section. And a 1, 2.
Out.
let the staccato quarter notes get so short that they can't develop only make them as long as you can and with a separation. Otherwise it gets yip, yip, yip. You said instead of yaw, yaw, yaw. You ready? We're going to begin at the staccato notes, which are ut di to, ut di to. One, two, three, go. Ut di to, Sopranos shook all over the place on Verdon. Toten was good, but Verdon was bad. Again. One, two, three, go. Ut di to, ha, 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 ha. See, good, good. We're gonna have fun with that when we get to it. Front row tenors, stand up, and come out of here and form a sort of an egg-shaped circle, and turn around, face the back. Now, and tenors at this end, turn in the second row, face the back of the hall. Right, that's what that. Don't each of you get egg-shaped. I mean, just as a group, right? And then the guys in the middle face towards the center, and the guys in the back face this way. Here we go. Give us one measure. Three and a four and a one. And sing. Nobody did a thing, you see, but they did it all themselves, and all you got to do is give an ignorant fellow like this the chance, and all of a sudden he becomes Geely, you see. Ready? Here we go. That's right. Now at this end, get in there a little bit. Go on, Chris, and then face it. Here we go. And one, two, three, go. That sounds better than the Santa Rosa Opera Company, you know? It really, really does. It sounds as good as Fullerton something or other, you know? But see, they sing that way all the time, you know, with your ears around on one side like this. Here we go, everybody, after they finish, here we go. Three and four. Sopranos do the same thing. And do sing into the sound you hear till it feels good. Ready? Two, three, four. Crescendo. Steady. Come on, alive. Oh. crescendo weave back and forth. It only goes to show that all choirs would sound better if nobody watched the conductor. That's right. But when, you know, when they listen, and when you're facing, even just sort of looking at one another, is a treat for some of us. No, but the point is that then all sorts of intangibles can enter, you know, and it's and those are the things. All right, now. We'll take a sort of a 7 to 10 minute break, and we'll move chairs around under directions from all of these famous people, and I'll be out and see you in a couple of seconds.
How do you prepare a score? What's your study procedure?
Right. Study procedure is first analysis, phrase analysis, harmonic analysis, metric analysis, in the style of that I learned from, and so many of us have learned in my generation from Julius Erfurt, who ended his life at doing doctoral studies at the University of Indiana, but also taught at Westminster Choir College for a number of years. And it comes out of the German analysis of the last, Schenker analysis of the last sort of half century. And then I do substantially, I solfège. I don't read very well. And unfortunately, I was crippled as a child mentally, and I couldn't play the keyboard. So I solfège substantially each line of the orchestra or each vocal part, and then I after I've done that structural analysis, I go through and I edit every on a basis of structural importance. I look at every note in every measure and assign it a dynamic or an expressivity. There may be on a score page, there may be 200 to 300 marks. The composer, I think, is too busy to worry. Beethoven writes forte right down the page. And if everybody plays forte, it's a schmear and nobody knows what's going on. And so what one has to do is say that the second horn has to play mezzo forte, but the third horn has to play almost fortissimo, and so on. And so you balance each vertical situation, and you express each longitudinal, so that you had not only let's just start with double forte. M, F, and M, P, and piano, and pianissimo, understand that one can go. Mr. Toscanini used to say that Verdi doesn't mean to sing piano unless he writes six of them.
you know. But here, and if you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times 10, you have 80 dynamic degrees. And so that's the third step. And then I, if I can, and if it's an historical piece that is that has some records, I will try to get maybe 6 to 10 other records to see how other people have done it, and see if there are any things I've sort of missed. I don't do that until I've done all my work and substantially turned it over. I haven't really turned it over to the library yet, because I may get some ideas from hearing other people, because there is, obviously, there is a tradition, and one should be aware of it. And then I feel like a fool at the first rehearsal and wonder and listen, and I learn from rehearsals. I try to listen as much as I can, and so that after the first rehearsal, the library will get my corrections of my own stupidity, the things that I marked wrong. But substantially, it's analysis, and then editing, and then listening, and then learning at rehearsal.
I wanted to ask how long it took you to develop your choral warm-up technique, and when it started, and how you got all those ideas.
It's changed through the years. I began, as some of you may know, I began sort of in professional music, aside from little 10 and 11 voice church choirs and stuff, which I did through college. I began with forming the Fred Waring Glee Club, which was doing Broadway show music. But I don't know why I began doing nonsense syllable singing first, and I don't suppose I've used this technique of count singing for more than... there are some members of the Atlanta Symphony Chorus here. I don't think I used it when I came to Atlanta. It's sort of the last 10 years, isn't it, Charles? It seems to me that an orchestra needs to sing and a choir needs to play. You know, these are the needs. And as a matter of fact, there was a time when I was very uncomfortable with an orchestra with a stick. But almost from the beginning, I picked up a pencil and began working with a choir, because it seemed to me that somehow it needed more particularity, and what the orchestra needed was a little bit of fluency, it had a little bit of, you know, wash of sound, obviously it leads me to say one thing about the warm up thing. I believe very, very thoroughly, I don't know whether you feel it or not, and it doesn't sort of make any difference to me whether you do or not. I know that it sort of works for me. I hope that nobody copies these sort of things without making them your own, you know, it's just silly that because it works for me that it should work for you. I hope it may give you, you know, make your own invention out of something that you heard or something you saw. But I'm very sure that the unison sort of sound that we now begin to get out of the sections comes directly from the warm up, and not simply from the rehearsal techniques of count singing. Right from the beginning of rehearsal, you establish a sort of unanimity of sound that is very difficult to escape if you have somebody as nasty as I am trying to hold you to it.
How does your role as conductor change from the rehearsal technician the closer you get to the performance?
I think one becomes a little more concerned with a little bit less concerned with the mechanics, and a little more concerned with the poetry, if you understand for a moment, as we are here. Yesterday, substantially, we didn't do anything but sort of, you know, but gymnastics, but finger exercises vocally, and the danger is, of course, that nobody does enough of them, and the real danger is that we do them and we make them dull, instead of make them alive. And somehow within this group, mostly because of your participation. That is to say, I was saying to the orchestra is coming tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. And I said, it's too bad because uh, that that uh, they can't have the same attitude as the chorus. And what I meant by it is that they're denied the possibility of having the same attitude. They don't have a full score. They don't have a full text. They don't have the whole residual philosophical background of Christianity, you know, for instance. They look at one solo line, you know, and all, and it has a little hairpin on it. And fortunately, you know, or it has a diminuendo or something, D-I-M. Hindemith in his book says that, you know, the only way for an instrumentalist to escape this awful sterility and boredom is to join a chorus and sing in an amateur chorus of, and the fewer voices, the better. You know, so that there's only one on a part, so that you really have to participate. A madrigal society. And then he says, and then you know, it's the only way you can keep your amateur standing. Amo amare, to love. You see, because it's tyrannized out of you. Imagine you've been raised as a very gifted kid, as a violinist, and your heart's burning to play, and you find out that really Isaac was a little bit better, you know, and Isaac is going to make it, and you don't quite have the same fingers that Isaac has, or whoever, you know, and so you take this wonderful instrument and all of this commitment, and you sit down, and a guy says, "You play it my way." You don't play it your way. You play it my way. And so the whole music business breeds affection out of us. And that's why I can't be sure in my own mind whether the musical culture of a society is better judged by the half dozen highly professional musical instruments in metropolitan centers of the greatest wealth and the greatest density of population, or whether it's to better be judged by what happens in the schools and the churches and the synagogues and oratorio societies and amateur groups. And there's no doubt that professional voices who are better equipped than yours and mine to do this, to do what we're doing, they're better equipped if they've got the same commitment, you see. And there's an awful lot of commitment that can be bred out if you can't find enough to eat. It's not that we're not getting off on choral singing, you know. But this is what it seems to be, what music is for, and that people can get together. And, you know, at the highest level of intellectuality, there's nothing more technically difficult than what we're trying to do, in a sense. Now, they're tougher pieces in certain repertoire and so on. But to get this right is about as difficult an intellectual accomplishment as the human mind can conceive. And we're trying to do it, we're trying to unify this many 140-some people in it. And also realizing that we can't do it without some sort of psychological, spiritual, whatever. I hate the word. I don't like that word spiritual because I think it's been cheapened too much. Affinity with our fellow man. We know we can't do it by oneself. And you cannot now find that in a voting booth. You certainly can't find it on the electronic church on Sunday morning. You know, it doesn't exist there. That's for sure. It exists in a rare pastor now and then, who has prophetic insight and can share it with us. But institutionalization is as dangerous for the church as it is for symphony orchestras. You see. As highly motivated as both of them may be, we're very fortunate to be in this situation, where we're doing it just for the love of Brahms. I think some of it started with the Greeks, you know, and some of it started with Jesus, you know, and some of it started with Johannes, and that those are the people who started, and we're starting each other too. I've been a better conductor today and yesterday in some minutes than I've been for some years, because I'm ennobled by your purpose.